If you never wrote any program in Python, here is some advice on the specifics of Python. If you know your way around Python, simply skip this segment. To indicate that the rest of the line is a comment, simply put a hash in front of that line. To create variables, simply type their name and write equals whatever you want. You do not specify the type of a variable, unlike in C or in Java or in C++ or in C#. Python is going to figure out the type on its own, like JavaScript, if you will. So that's an allowed name. Answer equals 42. Radius underscore of underscore earth is an allowed name, 6.371 times 10 to the 6th. I'm writing comment m to say meters. That's the simplest way of indicating what the measurement unit would be. And you must not start names with digits. 13 test 2 is not a correct name. The print command prints out what you have given after it. Very simple. If you want to specify more things, simply use commas. This now shows some basic arithmetics. I'll run it first to discuss the results. 42 is assigned to answer, 6.37 something times 10 to the 6th is assigned to radius underscore of underscore earth. Now we do some computation, 3 times answer plus 4, and the result is assigned to a variable called a. Note that multiplication and division are executed before plus and minus. Now we take the radius of earth to the second power. Asterisk represents the power operator in Python. Unlike C, unlike Java, parentheses work as they work in school. And again, the power operator 0.5, of course, meaning this is the square root. That's one way of writing the square root of a plus 3. The result is assigned to b. See, this is what the output here is, the second one. Gets pretty ugly. The content of answer is incremented by 7 plus equals 7. That's the same as in C and in Java and in JavaScript. The increment operator, the same works for minus equals, times equals, divided equals. What you can't do is plus plus, unlike C and its sibling. If you want to do plus plus, you have to write plus equals 1. This again is similar to C. If you divide integer numbers, 5 divided by 4, the result is an integer number. Let's look that up. C is the fourth one. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. 5 by 4 is 1 for Python, as is for C and for Java, and so on. If you want to see floating point division, at least one of these two numbers has to be a floating point number. Simply write 4 point. Let's look at D, second last. 1.25 works. Or 1.0 times 5 divided by 4. Python starts from the left, as does C, as does Java. 1.0 times 5 is a floating point number that's divided by the integer number. The result is a floating point number. Keep that in mind. This is something that easily leads to not so obvious errors. There's more to mathematics than arithmetics. To do more, we need to import the math library. This is done best at the start of a program. When we need the square root, we then can write math.square root of 4, which actually is the same as 4 asterisk 0.5. If we need the sine function, it's math.sine parentheses the angle. Of course, this angle is specified in radians, not in angular degrees. To convert from angular degrees to radians, multiply by pi, math.pi is a built-in constant, divided by 180. As lines get longer, we may need to break the line to keep it readable. If there is an open parenthesis, you can break at any point, then sometime close that parenthesis. If lines get longer, we may need to break them to keep things readable. Python is picky about lines. You cannot break anywhere. That's unlike C and Java. But if there's an open parenthesis, you can break anywhere. Python is going to wait for that closing parenthesis. For the standard mathematical functions, such as square root and sine, we need to import the math library. This is done best at the beginning of a program. And then you invoke the square root, for instance, by typing meth.squareroot, and the argument is given in parentheses. That's pretty similar to Java and to C sharp. The result, of course, is 2.0. We could also have written 4 to the 0.5th power. The sine function is meth.sine. The cosine would be meth.cos, and so on. The constant pi is included as meth.pi. The sine function and its friends work with radians, not with angular degrees. So if 23.4 is in angular degrees, we need to convert it, for instance, by multiplying with pi and dividing by 180. If lines get longer, you may want to break them to keep things readable. Python is picky about line breaks. That's very much unlike C and Java. You cannot break a line at any place, but if there is at least one open parenthesis, you can break the line. This is what I'm using here. If you need something to be done a given number of times, you can use the for loop, which looks quite different from C. First thing that you notice is a colon at the end. No braces, but a colon here at the end of the first line. And indentation. The indentation and that colon replace what C users know as curly braces. What happens here? H starts with 0, gets 1, 2, and so on, and at the end it's 6, and then the loop terminates. So you do not write for h equals 0 and so on, h smaller than 7, you write for h in range 7. That's the Python way. Let's have a look at the result. So it prints out square numbers starting with 0 and eventually terminating at 6 to the second power. The while loop is good for loops that run as long as something has to be done. So in this case, this loop runs as long as k is less than 130 or m is equal 140. So unlike C, you do not write pipe pipe for or, you simply spell out or. The same for not and end. Don't forget the colon. So we see that k runs up to 130. This first condition fails and the second one is not true either because m is 7000 something. Now to conditional execution. If the value of k is larger than 42, don't forget the colon, output high, a text string in single quotes. Else, that means if k was not larger than 42, check if m is larger than 43. If so, output hello. If not, which means if m is not larger than 43, output bye. And of course, k is larger than 42, it's 130, so we output high and never see the rest. The else is optional and the else if is optional. We need to work with long lists of data. This package called NumPy comes in handy here. NumPy.zeros creates a one-dimensional array, in this case with 5 entries numbered from 0 to 4, like in C. Here I changed the entry number 0, and here I changed the entry number 4, which is the last entry. I print the complete array, and here I print the ultimate entry. This comes in very handy and is different from C and other languages. So the complete array contains 20, 0, 0, 0, 99, because I changed the entry number 0 and I changed the entry number 4. And the entry number, if you will, minus 1 is simply the last one. Often we do not get away with one-dimensional lists. We have to use two-dimensional tables. This creates a table that's filled with zeros and has 2 rows and 3 columns. Here I changed the entry that's in the upper row, row number 0, and in the middle column, column number 1. Columns range from 0, 1, to 2, to 7. And here I change the entry in the lower row. The rows are 0 and 1. And in the rightmost column, 2, 8. I output that. And then I do some arithmetics with matrices, that is. We're going to cover that later. 1 plus twice the complete table that I built here. Let's look at the output. So, that's our array. 070 is the row number 0. 008 is the row number 1. We changed the entry, second column, row number 1 to 8. That's this guy. And here I computed 1 plus twice the array as above. The 7 becomes 1 plus 2 times 7, 15. The 8 becomes 1 plus 2 times 8, 17. This again is something that you can't do with regular arrays in C or in Java. This comes very handy for mathematics. And there's one more thing that resembles arrays in C and arrays in Java. If you think you copy that array, you didn't actually create a copy. You just created a reference to the very same thing in memory. So here I seem to create a copy. Q equals P. I changed the copy to make the left, the topmost left entry equal to 42. And then I output P. And you see, if I look at P, it too has the value of 42 in here. There is just one instance of that array in memory. Both Q and P refer to the same instance in memory. This is how we define functions in Python. We say def for define, function name, the parameters that we want to hand over to the function, colon, and then comes what the function should do. Again, of course, with indentation. And you call this function like you call math.sign and other built-in functions with parentheses, similar to C and Java. So in this case, u is set to 1. We compute 2 times u, r becomes 2, and we return 2 plus 1 equals 3. And in this case, it's 7. U is set to 7, r becomes 14, and we return 14 plus 7, that is 21.